sense, has a way of changing things. So people who are friends sometimes become not so friendly, and those who are not so friendly tend to become friends. Politics drives that. Can we have a little bit less movement inside, please? So what is happening in today's India, do you think, in politics? Because we see one party becoming a dominant party, winning not just general election, but winning state after state, and now aiming to get a notch or two lower into the communities through corporations and the like. Do you not think it's important in a dynamic democracy to have a good, thriving opposition as well?
First of all, thanks for all the kind words about me. It is nice to be here. Sunil, we are not winning because of charity of anyone. Okay. Let me be very clear about one thing.
Yeah.
We are winning because of the blessings of the people of India. And if a opposition is not winning, you should ask this question to them. Okay. In the first part. Let me scale this debate to a larger narrative of the changing profile of India. And that is very important for many of the young friends of the corporate world of the world. Indian democracy post-independence is now 70 years old. People of India know who they are and what they owe themselves. Second, people of India know they can unseat any political party howsoever popular, any political leader howsoever powerful, from the state or the center. This realization brings about a different kind of humility for those who are in politics. You better learn to perform and trust the people, otherwise they will show you the door and they will show you doors. The second thing, Sunil, is three phases of India's politics post-independence. Because you know, Sunil, I have been a keynote, as you rightly said, I'm an activist of my student life, I'm in the JP movement, I have gone to jail long times. I have been in charge of 8 states of India on behalf of my party, from Tamil Nadu to Assam, to Uttarakhand to Chhattisgarh to Rajasthan. In parliament for 17 years, minister in the Vajpayee government, minister again, and campaigning the country for more than 30 years. So I have seen India evolve. And whenever I go to any state as in charge, I observe that state, its sociological profile, its other. Now, my take is there are three phases of India's polity. First, the politics of want. Roti kaise milegi? Main hamesha kehta hu hindi mein is mulk mein roti baantne ki siyasat bahut hui hai. Roti ki sankhya badhni chahiye, ye siyasat bahut hui hai. If the bread is 5, distribution will be difficult. If bread is 50 lakh, distribution will be easy. And the best example I give, as an MP, I can give 100 gas connections. When I was an MP for the first time, it was 2000. There was a big queue. And we liberalized the Vajpayee regime. Now no one asked for it. That is how it works. The second, Sunil, is the politics of identity. The second phase. Caste, community, religion, region. This was the second phase of India's politics. And the third is politics of aspirational growth with good governance. India's current phase is the third phase. And therefore you see, Sunil, and the leading industries of India, you realize, even those who used to hate industries are now holding Mindmine Summit, Investor Meet, seeking investment. Because they know you need investment to create jobs. That is a changing phase of India. What is my take as a political activist? This debate between equity and growth is a perennial debate. And my take is, growth without equity is possible. It will be pro-rich, it will be pro-feudal, it will be pro-capital. But genuine equity cannot come without growth. You need to enlarge the cake to distribute it well. And for that you need investment, more taxes, more revenue, more reforms, more facilitation. The money comes to be given for the poor. This I see is the changing profile of India politically speaking, and it's a good profile. It's a good profile.
So why your thoughtfulness? Last year when you came to the Mindmine Summit, you brought a copy of the original Indian Constitution with you.
I ought to have brought it this time also.
So I was wondering what you brought for us this time. So tell us a little about the interesting plan you were developing to set up BPOs in the rural parts of Bihar and other states.
I must tell you, you are giving me to give me a brief profile of digital India. And just give me 5 minutes time and I am ready to take as many questions on that.
Sure.
Well, friends, digital India is a transformative. Digital India, Make in India, Skill India, Startup India, Stand-up India, all are working in sync to make India a digitally empowered society. Not only digitally enabled, digitally empowered. And the second, digital India is more for the poor and underprivileged. Lift the quality of life. To bring a digital divide. Now what is the digital profile of India, ladies and gentlemen? In a population of 1.25 billion, we have got 108 billion mobile phones, 350 million smartphones, likely to become 500 million in the coming 2 years. We have got 113 crore, 1.13 billion Indians on Aadhaar card, 500 million internet, landline, and wireless. The biggest startup movement, India today is ranked number 3 after America and China in startups. Now how...
It's actually become number 2 now.
Oh, number 2, thank you. I'm so happy. Then keep me giving this information. Now kindly see how we are bringing in digital inclusion. We opened Jandhan account of the poor. 280 million, 28 crore account in 2 years. We're out of the banking system. We seeded that to Aadhaar, also linked it to mobile. And all the subsidy for the poor started going to the bank accounts. Gas ki subsidy, ration ki subsidy, kirasan ki subsidy. We saved 50,000 crores, nearly $8 billion plus, which used to be pocketed by the middlemen or the fiduciaries. बेटी पैदा नहीं हुई, बड़ी हो गई और विधवा पेंशन ले रहे हैं. Now you talk of rural BPO. How this rural BPO scheme came? And I'm so happy. Day before yesterday, I nominated the first BPO in Patna. Okay. And I do see the spark of light in the face of young boys and girls. After becoming the IT minister in 2014, I had gone to Bangalore. I was addressing a lot of IT friends. When I was coming out, a lot of young boys from Bihar and UP were there. I come from Bihar, welcome. And I remember their words, Ravi Bhaiya kuch aisa kariye, ki apne gaon laut sake. And then the idea struck me, ki India's digital profile, though rich, is very restricted. Delhi, you are Gurgaon, Noida, Bombay, Pune, Chennai, Hyderabad, Bangalore, Mysore, that's all. The rest all were only computer training centers. And from there came this rural BPO scheme, 48,000 seats allocated to states as per their population. UP got 8,000, Bihar got 4,600 likewise. 1 lakh rupees subsidy per head, and subsidy to be distributed if you employ a woman, 5%. If you employ a disabled, 2%. If you promote local entrepreneur, 10%, like that. To me, it's a matter of such great pride for me personally. If BPO is coming in Patna, in Muzaffarpur, in Kannauj, you know, in Bulandshahr, in Itawa, in Gorakhpur, it is a new digital India emerging with the involvement of the local people. So that's how, and I can only tell you, we are promoting digital delivery of services in a very big way. We are going to launch very soon to the Digi Village, Digital Gaon, 1,000 villages in the country as a pilot. Where e-health, e-study. And lastly, I inaugurated yesterday because I know Sunil, delivery of justice is an area of your concern. I have promoted a big movement of common service center in the country. Many of you may be knowing. And I request you, let Mindmine do some study on their working. They are young boys, girls, Dalit ladies who are giving digital delivery of services in the rural community, internet. Who gas ki subsidy dete hain, ration card help karte hain, banking correspondents hain, wo PAN card banate hain, Aadhaar card banate hain. Ramdev Baba ki dawai bhi bech rahe hain, scaling the center par. Now what happened? I have going to start nearly 1800 gram panchayats in the pilot project, where a paralegal trainer will be there to give access to justice to the poor girls or boys or poor people, pre-litigation advice. Link to the video conferencing in the panel of lawyers of a state legal center. So how you can digitally even give access to justice also? So these are some of the novel projects which are doing. Well, friends, in conclusion, I can only tell you, I was just in Germany last week. Digital India today is being recognized world over. Respected. Now, I come from Bihar. People from Bihar used to come to Ames. They have to take registration for 3 months. I told my department to find a way out. Now, digitally, you can get registered. Mandi for agriculture people. Unko apni fasal bechni hai. At a click of a button, 15 mandis will be before you with their price. Go and negotiate. They're going to say they're at 250. E-scholarship. Digital platform for common service delivery. All is working well. I can only say Digital India is now being talked about. But what is a matter of assurance for me? Digital inclusion is being created. And how I encourage for my young female friends. Abhi Sunil, we had a trade fair on Digital India. There is Lady Bajanti Devi of Bihar, a Dalit, who runs a common service center, and Baki. हमने कहा इसकी बड़ी फोटो लगाओ मेरी फोटो छोटी लगाओ एंड व्हेन दे केम हमने कहा यू आर द क्रिएटर ऑफ मॉडर्न इंडिया लेट यू टेक द लाइमलाइट दैट्स हाउ आई एनकरेज देम
Yesterday, Suresh Prabhu had come, Srimati Nirmala Sitharaman came, Vijay Sinha, Amitabh Kant, all of them told us about these very lofty grand plans and what is going on, like you're telling us. So where are your problems at this moment? Where are your challenges? From what we hear, it appears already that we are getting to a utopian state.
No.
Are we quite there?
No, I will never say that. I would put it this way. Things have started to happen. We need to accelerate this happening. I'm very modest. For instance, in this highly cantankerous polity of India, we would succeed in having GST or not, let me tell you, by the same process. Education, taking them on board, manufacturing state, non-manufacturing state, this whole Digital India program. Today, I'm happy. Aadhaar, I talked about Aadhaar. Now, some people are having problem with Aadhaar. Poor people are not having problem with Aadhaar. And today, I hope I'm having my Aadhaar. I want to explain it to my crowd. I hope I'm here.
The IT minister must put in the Aadhaar.
Now, you see, what does it contain? It contains my name, my date of birth, I'm a male, and my partner address, permanent address. That's all. It does not contain my parentage, my caste, or community, or my education, or my income, or my medical history. By which you can be profiled, it's not there. And the system has my biometrics, my eyes, that's all. And you all need to understand that if a banker is seeking authentication, Aadhaar system does not know for what purpose he is seeking authentication, for opening an account or all. If for your product, Sunil, tomorrow you decide that we'll have Aadhaar linkage, Aadhaar system doesn't know Sunil's company is seeking that for what purpose. We only authenticate if you are very sure. Second, the Aadhaar law is so tough, even as an IT minister, if I disclose my fingerprints and iris clinic on authorized purpose, I can also be prosecuted for 3 years and sentenced. That is the law we have made. Poor people are happy, they are very happy, but some people, Aadhaar, privacy, secrecy, I don't like India in democracy, but for these people, I always say, gently, Sunil, aapko Narendra Modi se parashani hai. You have got a powerful pen, we don't brush that, or some kaam karte rahe. That's how it is.
We are very keen to grow manufacturing in India. Make in India is one of our big ambitious programs. What do you think we can actually do to make it happen?
Very, very big question. How the digital ecosystem of India is doing, ladies and gentlemen? In my electronics decade, where I sit in the 90s, I sit in Shastri Grand Congress. There is a portal, e-tab, which records every digital movement in India. You purchase a railway ticket digitally, record it. You have income tax return digitally, you will record it. In 2013, it was 66 lakh transactions per day. In 2014, it was 96 lakh transactions per day. In 2015, it was 1.85 crore transactions per day. In 2016, it was 3 crore transactions per day. In 2017, it is 3.75 crore transactions per day. All automatically recorded. The digital payment which have started, a great game changer. The Bheem has 2 crore. Now you rightly put, India is a big hardware. And for a lot of my young friends, give me 2 minutes time. Indian, I'm very proud of the IT Minister of India's IT companies. They have kept the flag of India flying. They are present in 200 cities of 80 countries. The total revenue today is nearly 150 crores. They have exported IT products worth 7 lakh crore, the highest last year. They give job to 1 crore people indirectly, 30 lakh directly, and one third are women. That is the scale on which Indian IT company works. And let me make one a clear statement today, so you have presence in my name. Indian IT company don't steal jobs, they create jobs wherever they go. In USA, they have met 2/3 of the Fortune companies as competitive by giving Bangladesh. They have given $20 billion as taxes to American revenue kitty, including CSR. But yes, software has been a great success story. We need also to enlarge the hardware. When you talk about Make in India, I'm very happy to tell you, I mentioned last year about the initial success. Modi ji asked me, Ravi Shankar, tum kehte ho 108 crore phone hai, bande kehte hai. I got the hint, and today I'm very happy to tell you, ladies and gentlemen, 72 new mobile manufacturing factories have come in India in the last 2 years. 42 mobile manufacturing and 30 component battery charger, etc. And so then your Noida, Total Noida is emerging as a big hub, so into factories are coming. 17 crore mobile phones are being manufactured this year, 12 crore last year have been manufactured. And the theme was Make in India for India and also export to neighboring countries, ASEAN countries and Middle East. And our government has come electronic manufacturing, only 11,000 crores have been invested, proposed to be. Now it is 1,27,000 crores. Auto electronics, defense electronics, medical electronics, consumer electronics, all are rising in a very big way. And I'm happy this hardware power is emerging. And ladies and gentlemen, what is the potential I see of India? Digital economy of India, mark my word. Digital economy of India, when I say so, digital economy, I mean communication. I mean IT and IT enabled services, software and hardware. I mean digital payment. I mean e-commerce, I also mean cybersecurity, because cybersecurity is also emerging as a big area of our economy. It is going to be a $1 trillion economy in the coming 5 to 7 years. And that is what I am aiming at, and that's what India is going to showcase to the world. That's my
question. Fantastic.
I take your point. I'll tell my officers to explore it more, and I'll personally look into it. But I have a different view. I need to take your observation seriously. My take in public life has been, let your work speak for you. And if your work starts speaking for you, the world starts taking notice. Today, the UN report has said, Aadhaar is a phenomenal technology. Other countries are asking for Aadhaar. There was an article against me in the Chinese newspaper. This man is taking Chinese company into Indian mobile manufacturing. No problem. If your work starts speaking for you, the world starts taking notice. But I take your point, we'll look at it.